Hello everyone and welcome to this talk about board support packages. My name is Tomaš. I work as embedded software engineer at Espressif, and today I will show you our new project that will help you getting started with development boards built on Espressif SoCs. So as you can see, there are only 4 points in our agenda, so we should make it something under 20 minutes. So let's get started. A development board is a great way of starting prototyping on Espressif chips. However, it is not always easy to put together all drivers for onboard chips and to configure your shiny new development board for something more profound than just a mere hello world example. So the first point is a mock example project where we will clearly see how painstaking it can be to bring your new dev board to life. And in the second point, we will see how BSPs can help you tackle this problem. Following that, we will take a look at how BSPs are distributed and what role IDF Component Manager plays in BSPs deployment. And last but not least, we will talk about how you can contribute or request new features and what the future might bring to BSP project. So as the name Board Support Packages suggests, we will be talking about development board today. And I picked one ESP32 S2 Kaluga kit to present you a problem that many developers face in their beginnings and how BSP can be of use in this case. So consider this. You just got a brand new ESP32 S2 Kaluga kit in your box and you open it and you see what you have inside, and you just want to put this hardware into action. So first thing you see is the camera display and so it sounds as a good idea to get image from the camera onto the display. Then you find that in the box there is also a small speaker. So you start thinking that your first project could play some music too. There's actually a connector on this side of the board. We can see it here, but there's a power amplifier and a connector for speaker. So now, if you are a novice, you might fall prey to a naive idea that accomplishing this might be a piece of cake without any higher level software component. I'm not saying that it's extremely complex, just that it's rather daring goal for a very first try. Anyway, you can get inspired with many open source examples that are available on GitHub and try to get all these pieces of code of different origin working together. Although it is possible, we wanted to provide users with better experience when they start developing or exploring new features of their development boards. But now let's take a step back and let us have a look at how many things you have to configure before you can get this simple, in quotes, project done. In this picture, you can see a block diagram of ESP32 S2. It is taken from ESP32 S2 datasheet, so you might have already seen it somewhere. I will zoom in on the peripherals and sensor section so we can start thinking about what we need in our example project. So we definitely need a display and the LCD interface. We also need a camera, so that's camera interface and some GPIOs. And then we need audio, so that would be I2S peripheral and I2C for configuration. We'll also be using FreeRTOS and some graphics libraries, so we'll need some general purpose timers. Then we also, it would be a nice feature if we could control the brightness of the display, so we would use the PWM module for this. It sounds that that might do it, but you will soon find out that the ESP32 S2 does not have enough internal RAM to hold frame buffers from the camera and the display. So we also need support for external RAM. Now, what is not in this picture are DMAs, because we also need DMAs. We certainly don't want to spend our CPU time passing huge data frame buffers from one place to another. So setting up DMA for the camera, for the audio and the LCD is just a must. Moreover, DMAs will get even more complicated since we need DMA access to external RAM. So as you can see, we use a large number of peripherals in this chip and we just started. But the list is still pretty far from being complete, because you also need drivers for the external components. So we need a driver for the audio codec to play the music. We need a driver for the display driver to get the image on the display. And we also need another driver for the camera module. But we still need to move forward. We also need to know the board's pinout. We also need some graphics library to serve the display. And the last but not least, we need some code that will put all these components together. So maybe there is something that I forgot to mention, but this list sounds complete. So as you can see from a simple example, we have a rather complicated problem. And it will take a significant amount of time to configure all the named peripherals and to put this all together. Now, this is where a Boards Pro package comes in handy. BSP solves all the name problems and allows you to start developing your first application a lot quicker. You can see a typical BSP composition in the picture on the right. Typically, BSP contains complete pinout of the board. That is convenient for both using the macros in your code as well as form of documentation. So you don't need to have the schematic of the board open all the time. Next, we have some default configurations of internal peripherals or external components, because many software components have thorough configuration, but usually it's good to start with defaults and then later you will see what you need to change. Then we move to drivers for external components themselves. It can be sensors, audio codecs, or any other peripherals. And lastly, we get the glue. That is a number of helper functions that will save you a lot of time by aggregating few to several functions and configurations into one. For example, you would need just a simple one-liner to mount a micro SD card, or just another one-liner to initialize your LCD display with touch controller and the graphics library. Now, when you look at the picture again, you can see that these external components are marked as there is multitude of them. That also means that these external components are not like integral part. They are not hard-coded in the BSP, but they are rather separate components. They can be used separately. They have their own lifecycle and own versioning, but the BSP depends on them. I will try to explain it a little more in next slides. Okay, so if you want to use BSP in your project, you need to add it to your project as a dependency. Then during build, it will download all the required code, including the external components, and then it's ready to use. So going back to the example project that we discussed, all the relatively complicated configuration is now just few lines of code, or 5 lines of code, as you can see here. So looking at this code snippet, firstly, we initialize I2C that is used for both camera and audio codec configuration. Then with BSP display start, we initialize SPI that is used for color and configuration interface to the LCD. We set up LVGL, the graphics library, and allocate required memory and start the FreeRTOS tasks. Then on the next line, we turn on the display backlight, which essentially just turns on the display. The last two lines are for camera configuration. These functions and configuration structure comes directly from ESP32 camera package. Configuring the camera component is rather difficult. There are many different modes the camera can operate. And in Kaluga BSP, we want to keep the flexible interface ESP32 camera offers. So we provide default configuration macros, such as this one, that will shrink the complicated configuration into one line. So after you run these few lines, your application is configured and ready to get frame buffer from your camera to external RAM, and then through LVGL and SPI to your display, all while another frame is being fetched from the camera. And with a few more lines, you can get the audio coded working with in a similar manner. So I really believe that BSP can save you a lot of time, mostly in the beginnings, and a lot of trouble. And you can get your first prototype working faster than before. Now, let's have a more detailed look on how BSPs are distributed and integrated into ESP IDF project. So to get a specific board support package into your project, you shouldn't clone the whole ESP-BSP repository because it serves as catalog. It contains source code of all BSPs and their components. You only want the one BSP that you really need for your board. So this is where IDF Component Manager plays an important role. There is a separate talk about IDF Component Manager at this conference, so I won't go into too much detail about, but the important thing is that BSPs are distributed via our IDF Component Registry. It's fully integrated in the IDF build system, so in most cases, you don't need to know the internals. You just define that your project depends on a BSP, and that is all. I'll show you how to do that later. But apart from the integration in IDF build system, the IDF registry also offers a nice web user interface where you can browse all IDF components, including BSPs. For example, on this picture, if I search for a word board in the IDF component registry, it will show me a list of relevant components. That is BSP for Bureau Workit or for Azure Kit and or about the Kaluga Kit that we are working with today. If I click on one of these, I get to the main page of that component. I can see the README, the license that this component is released, its version, and a list of supported targets. Now here I can see a IDF.py command that would add this BSP into my project. So it's just IDF.py add dependency, name of the component or BSP, and then optional version. And then BSP is in your project. Then probably the most interesting part is on the bottom right, is the dependency section. It lists components that will be added to your project with this BSP. So you can think about BSP as a software component that depends on or needs other software components. We have separate components for camera modules or the ES311 audio codec. And these are automatically downloaded and added to your project together with this BSP. With this way, we have a modular software architecture where individual components are separated from each other, offering clean interfaces that can be reused across projects and development boards. Now we are almost at the end. So in this final slide, there are a few pieces of information that just didn't deserve their own slide. As almost all code in Espressif, ESP-BSP is open source on GitHub, and you are welcome to contribute file issues or suggest new features. We'll get back to you as soon as possible. Another point is that ESP-BSP is kept up to date with ESP IDE Master and release version 4.4. We do our best to provide fixed APIs to access BSP functions. Anyway, we have semantic versioning in place, so you can work with fixed version of the BSP and you don't have to worry about changes in BSP or IDF. And this is actually connected with another thing, because although compatibility with latest IDF is in general a big advantage, for some this can be seen as disadvantage. Since BSPs depend on ISP IDF drivers, they are intended for usage with ESP IDF. So if you are a fan of ESP Arduino project, you will have to use their solution for development boards. At this point, I should also add that we don't want ESP-BSP to be only for development boards from us, from Espressif, but eventually we would like to have support for third-party development boards too, if they are built on Espressif chips, of course. And the last point I would like to highlight is support for multiple small devices, such as sensors, display and touch controllers, some of which we discussed today. Because as I said in the beginning, we wanted to provide you with complete package that contains drivers for external components too. The most notable is the display framework built around LVGL graphics library, where we keep updating a list of supported LCD and touch drivers that can be used not only in BSP prototyping, but also in custom board projects. The most notable features that are implemented in this display framework that were missing previously are multi-display support that you can have several displays connected to ESP32, display rotation, and improved touch support. These software components can be used also without the board support package, that means on your custom boards and products. So if your application contains graphics, you should definitely check it out. And that brings us to the end of this presentation. I hope you like the ideas, and I'll be happy to hear from you at our standard channels, that is ESP32 forum and ESP-BSP repository on GitHub. Bye-bye.